All right, welcome to How to Make Sense of Cybersecurity Frameworks. Now, it turns out that in security, we often have a hard time communicating what we do and what we know about security to other people. A lot of times we speak in acronyms or hard to understand terms that non-security professionals don't necessarily understand. Has anybody experienced or witnessed this before? Yeah, right? Well, this is related to a syndrome that is often referred to called the curse of knowledge. Now, the curse of knowledge is when we are, or anybody in any field, is so knowledgeable about a specific area that they find it hard, difficult, almost impossible to communicate about that topic to others in simple terms. Well, you would think that out of the vast array of cybersecurity frameworks that we have available to us in the industry, that we should be able to simplify the things that we are actually communicating. If anybody has spent any time looking at the various security frameworks that are available out there, you will find that this alphabet soup of security frameworks oftentimes makes things more complicated, right? Well, these sets of security frameworks, what we want to do today in this session is I want to share with you a very simple approach, for thinking about the various cybersecurity frameworks that are available in the marketplace. And really, this simple approach is just bucketing, segmenting all of the different frameworks into three different categories. Number one, what are the different control frameworks that are available? Number two, what are the different, what I like to call, program frameworks? And number three, what are the different risk frameworks that are available? And as a manager, as a leader, as a security practitioner, just by thinking about those different types of frameworks and seeing how they fit, apply to your environments, you will have a much better ability to simplify what we're talking about from an overall security perspective. Make sense? All right, now before we get into all of the details, I want to talk a little bit about cooking. Now, just for a moment, imagine that you want to become a world-class chef. But unfortunately, like me, you actually don't know anything about cooking. Well, what does it take to become a world-class chef? First of all, you need to understand what are the different ingredients. What are the things that you can buy at the market, at the store, that will help you make the wonderful meal that you were planning to make? But it's not just about the list of different ingredients, which are essentially like the different controls that we might all want to implement in our security programs, but it's about combining these different ingredients into a pleasing combination, and to combine them into a pleasing combination to make a delicious meal, well, a lot of times we need a recipe, a cookbook. How do we put these things together? What spices go well together? What flavors go well together? How much salt do we actually need to add? And this is where we've got our program frameworks, if you will. What are common approaches, common recipes? A cookbook that contains the common ways in which we want to assemble these different security activities, all of the controls that we have at our disposal. Has anybody gone to the supermarket, the grocery store, the superstore, and made the mistake of going when you were hungry? Right? When you go when you're hungry, you come back with a lot more stuff, a lot more ingredients than you might have actually wanted. In those cases, our eyes are bigger than our stomach in that particular case. And we see this a lot of times in security as well. So we want to make sure that we think about, well, how do we structure our overall program? What is the cookbook that we want to follow? We'll be talking about various program frameworks that can help us do that, help us organize our various activities. And then finally, number three, if our goal is to become a world-class chef, it's not enough to make one nice meal, one delicious meal. You also, hopefully, want to have a great, amazing restaurant. Now, it's not enough to say, well, what's the main course, what's the appetizer, what's the dessert? You also want to create an environment that your patrons, your customers, actually value. Does the restaurant have the right vibe? Does it have the right decor? Right? Does it have something that people will want to keep on coming back to? How do we figure that out? That is related to our various risk frameworks that we're going to discuss. So here, in the rest of this presentation, is divided into three different parts. We're going to go do an overview of some of the most common control frameworks, number one, some of the common program frameworks, and some of the most common risk frameworks. It turns out that over time, I've got a number of colleagues, I have a number of clients, that when they are starting to build their security program, build their security team, and it's a young team, it's a new team as part of perhaps a younger organization, well, there's a little bit of maturation that has to occur. As your experience grows over time, you will start to incorporate some number of control, program, and risk elements, frameworks, into your overall organization. And we see on the left-hand side here some common examples of these. So we're going to go ahead and go through these one at a time. First, starting with various control frameworks. So the first control framework, what we first want to talk about in terms of control frameworks is why. Why do we want to use a control framework? Well, we all, I think, know that this is the foundation of all of our security programs. What are the specific controls, the activities that we need to implement in our organizations to help protect us against the adversary, protect us against the bad guys? Well, as a CISO, I've been thrust into various situations where I find myself in a new organization with a new team. Well, and sure, certain security activities are occurring, but right, these are occurring in an ad hoc manner. So what we first want to do is identify, well, what is the baseline set of controls that we want to have in place, that we need to implement in our organizations so that we can figure out what is the current state of our various technical capabilities. I was just talking to a client the other day, and they said, well, where should I start? And said, they gave me a little bit of background, said, well, let's go ahead and start thinking about these control frameworks so that we can prioritize what your team should actually be working on, that initial roadmap for your security program. So here, let's go ahead and talk about two different examples. The first example of a control framework that we're going to talk about is NIST, National Institute of Standards and Technology, SP, Special Publication 853. Now, I think it's many people know that NIST regularly publishes various security information, security-related documents and standards that are part of, typically, the 800 series family. This one standard in particular, 853, is intended to be a comprehensive control catalog. Basically, what is the full list of ingredients that you might want to have to create your amazing dish? In this particular example, what is the full list of ingredients that you could potentially implement in your overall security program? Quick show of hands. Who uses NIST 853 in their organizations? All right, many, many folks. Looks like 50 or 60% of people. And you can see that SP 853 is divided up into 18 different control families here that are things that we commonly do, commonly implement in our organizations, in our teams. So let's go ahead and talk a little bit more about this. Not only do we have the overall family, we've got the specific controls, and we have what they call a control enhancement. We'll talk more about that on the next slide. But the important thing to keep in mind here is that 853 intended to be a comprehensive control catalog, the list of all of the ingredients that could potentially go into your recipes. Will you ever implement all of the 853 controls in your organization? Of course not. I see a number of shaking heads. No, you won't. It's too many. Just like in a dish, you're never going to put all of the ingredients into them. One of the things that 853 calls out is that, hey, you can implement these controls based on a couple different approaches, based on your priority, that we'll see in a moment, and what they call your security control baseline. Is your organization, your department, your company, is it operating in a low impact, moderate impact, or high impact environment? Based on the risk profile, you're going to decide to implement a different set of these various controls. So if we go ahead and take a look at it in a little bit more detail, I mentioned that there is the control family, right? There's the control itself, and there is the control enhancement. Well, on the far left-hand side, we double-clicked here. We zoomed in to the access control family, simply as an example. AC on the left-hand side, of course, stands for access control, and you've got the specific control names. Ah, but in the third column here, notice we mentioned the priority. In this example, per the NIST definition, it says that certain controls have a P1 or a P2 or a P3 priority, meaning that certain controls should be, they suggest, you implement them first, depending on your environment. But additionally, right, you can have a low, moderate, or high over here on the right-hand side. Depending on the risk profile of your organization, you might decide to implement more controls in the high-impact environment versus lesser, fewer controls in the low-impact environment. But there's some tweaks, some nuances here. In the far lower right-hand corner, we've got this little parentheses, parentheses number one. And that refers to a control enhancement. The bottom row, session lock. I think we all know what session lock is. You log into a website, right? After some period of time, it times out. You log into your desktop. After some period of time, it locks you out, and you've got to log back in. Well, that little one in parentheses, that control enhancement in the lower right-hand corner says that if you are operating in a high-impact environment, in that particular case, you should also ensure not only that you have a session lock, but you should also ensure that, hey, when the machine locks, sometimes your operating system. For example, if you've got, who here does not have a mobile device in their pocket? Right? We all have a mobile device. It turns out that in most mobile devices, when you click the button, when you go back to the home screen, it takes a screenshot of the current app that you're viewing. Well, when it does that, if you're doing your online banking at that particular time, you click the button, you go back to the home screen, it will take a screenshot of your current screen. Now, based on this control enhancement, this says that in high assurance environments, you don't want sensitive data to be disclosed in that screenshot. So if you have that particular situation, make sure that the contents of the screen are not visible or not captured in the screenshot itself. Make sense? Right. So that is 853, one example of a specific control. Now, we talk here about some initial prioritization, and we talk about 853 being a comprehensive control catalog. And so since we're never going to implement all of these in our organization, how do we start to whittle this down even a little bit more? And that brings us to the CIS, the Center for Internet Security Controls. Now, the Center for Internet Security Controls, they've had a long history. Originally started back in the day, as referred to then as the consensus audit guidelines, then became the critical security controls managed by SANS, and has since been moved over to the Center for Internet Security, now officially called the CIS controls, but I still commonly refer to it as the CSC critical security controls as well. Now you can see that there are top 20 critical security controls. Now why is this important? When the controls were first created, right, when we were looking at vulnerabilities originally, right, at the NSA, right, the red team would go in and find vulnerabilities in different systems. Well, over time, when they continued to find those vulnerabilities, the blue team finally said, look, we're fed up. When are you going to come to us with some actual recommendations how to prevent these things from occurring in the future? And that was the genesis of what is now the CIS controls. What are some of the most common controls that mitigate the most common attacks, let's say 80% of the attacks? And now, these controls are divided up into the various basic, foundational, and organizational controls. 50 to 60% of you, a few moments ago, said that you were using 853. Quick show of hands, who is using the CIS controls in your environment? All right, that is also 50, 60% of folks. All right, so another very popular control framework. Now, why do we mention this? Well, the controls, these control frameworks, the ingredients that we need to build our overall program, have been shown to be extremely successful. U.S. Department of State, they say 90% risk reduction in their first year of formally utilizing the controls. Australian Defense Services Directorate stopped 85%. 85% of attacks that their SOC was seeing were actually blocked by implementing those controls. Federal Reserve System uses it as the basis to audit various controls as well. And one small note on the bottom of this slide. This is an online resource that's available online in the SANS Reading Room, which is just a collection of various white papers created, written by the community. A small business, no budget implementation of the controls. If you don't have a big budget, huge budget, that's okay. You can start to implement the controls in your organization as well. So we talk about these controls here as the first bucket, the first tier, the first segment of our security frameworks. And as we are using these, there are also some free resources that are available. Auditscripts.com, James and Kelly Tirala, have created a couple free, really valuable resources. Number one, the audit scripts control master mapping. So we just saw some examples, some portions of these control frameworks. There are many, many controls. Well, how do we map them to each other, to different frameworks, as we're going to see later, but also map them to the compliance, regulatory, and other requirements that you have in your organizations? Well, James and Kelly, in this spreadsheet, this tool, have pre-mapped many of these for you as well. Extremely useful reference. We also said that you can start to use a control framework to get a sense of prioritization, where you actually need to implement more, where you've already implemented a lot. There's also this tool, second bullet here, the control manual assessment tool, very lightweight tool that you can go in and answer some questions about each of the controls in your environment and get a sense of, okay, how well are we doing? You self-assess how you're doing from an overall control implementation perspective. And then lastly, of course, CIS themselves, cisecurity.org, has the controls implementation guide in terms of some key questions to ask yourself when actually implementing these controls. Quick show of hands, has anybody used any of these tools before? All right, maybe 10, 15, 20% of folks. All right, definitely recommend checking these out in terms of helping, aiding in your adoption, implementation of these various controls. So that is number one. Those are the various control frameworks. Number two, we want to talk about different program frameworks, different program frameworks in our organizations. Now, why do we separate this? Why do we talk about program frameworks separately? I had a meeting, I talk about this all the time, because it sticks in my memory. I had a meeting with my CFO once, and she, about 5 minutes into the meeting, stopped me. You know, of course, I was there to get her buy-in on our security program, hopefully, which would lead to more investment and so on. 5 minutes into the meeting, she stops me, and she's a little bit frustrated, I could tell. She says, "Frank, we get it. In finance, we understand. We know that security is important. But what we want to know is, are we spending too much? Are we spending too little? Are we spending more than our competitors in the industry?" She was asking, of course, that typical bear in the forest question. Are we running faster than our friend, or running faster than the bear in the forest who's chasing us, or running faster than our friend who the bear is also chasing? And so we talk about program frameworks here, because imagine when my CEO, when my CFO, when they ask, "Hey, how are we doing from a security perspective?" and I give them the 853 list of all controls, or give them the list of the top 20 controls and all of the sub-controls, and say, "This is how we've done all of these things." Is that going to be understandable to them? Generally not, generally not. Now, I will caveat that and say, remember I said that for a new team, a young organization, I have clients, I've done this myself in a new organization, is we start with the controls. And we say, this is our progress to implementing various controls. But the problem is you can't just stop there. You have to give your CEO, your CFO, other business partners a full picture to say, look, within 6 months, within a year and a half, this is where we're going to get to in terms of implementation of the controls. And once we get a little bit more mature, that's when we think about the program framework to give you this higher level view of what our overall security activities are. And as we continue to mature, right, a little bit at the same time, we sprinkle this some extra salt in there, and we say, this is how we're going to utilize risk frameworks to further inform, prioritize what we're actually doing. So the key takeaway from a program framework is to help us simplify communications with business leaders so that they can better understand what we're doing from a security perspective. So in this section, I want to talk about two different program frameworks. First, before we get into the details of the specific frameworks, let's talk a little bit about ISO 27000. Now, ISO 27000, ISO, of course, is the Organization for International Standardization. Now, ISO publishes many different documents, many different standards, but their 27000 series is a family of standards for information security we see referenced up here. The first one, 27001, defines your ISMS, your Information Security Management System, their way of describing your security program, defines the various requirements. 27002 defines implementation guidance, and you can see a number of others here as well. Now, zooming in to 27001, that specifically talks about those ISMS requirements. Here, in addition to the controls themselves, 27001 describes different areas of focus. Why are these areas of focus important? Well, they go beyond the security-specific controls that we were talking about. Specifically, they say, well, what do you think about organizational context? What do we mean by organizational context? We're talking about the business requirements, the goals and strategy and vision for the organization as a whole. What is the organization trying to achieve? And how is that related to leadership in terms of roles and responsibilities, team structure, program structure? Is there a strategic planning process in place other than just continuing to implement more and more technical controls? And then other organizational activities like support, documentation, ongoing operations, and continuous improvement as well. Quick show of hands, who here has some part of their organization, some system, some application that has to be 27,000 compliant? All right, maybe about 40% of folks. Now, in general, I find that, well, many organizations, especially here in North America, decide not to jump straight away to 27001 compliance and use this as a program framework. Why not? Why not? Well, because 27001 tends to be a little bit more comprehensive. Now, you would think that's a good thing, right? More comprehensive, but more comprehensive meaning that is more rigorous, more time-consuming, more resource-intensive, and therefore more costly to actually implement 27001. Now, certain types of organizations, like cloud providers. Why does basically every major cloud provider have 27001 certification for their different systems and services? They want to do business all around the world, and they want to prove to their customers around the world that they have achieved some of the highest level assurance for the various services that they're actually offering. And so 27001 is also especially more popular outside of North America, outside of the United States as well, because it is an international standard. So if we go ahead and zoom in here to 27001, it defines various control objectives. And you can see that there are 15 different control objectives listed here on the slide. Now, out of all of these control objectives, you can see that there are typical things like access control, which we saw in 853, like encryption of our data in transit, data and rest, incident response, incident management. But there are also things on this list that are more organizationally related, like our, from a governance perspective, like in the top left, our security policies, bottom left, HR security, management of test data in the middle as well. So 27001 broadens the scope a little bit of the types of things that we explicitly have to deal with from an overall program level in our organizations. So that is ISO 27001, the one example of a program framework. So the second example of a program framework here is, of course, the NIST Cybersecurity Framework, CSF. I personally love the NIST Cybersecurity Framework. Quick show of hands, who here uses CSF in their organizations? Wow, that is, I don't know, 70% of folks. And the reason I love it is because it is so simple. Instead of communicating to non-technical, non-security people about all of the details of the controls that we're implementing, we can instead talk about the core. The core of this framework really models the life cycle of security that all of our organizations are following. We identify what we need to do. We identify our environment, our assets. We identify bad things that couldn't occur, the various governance-related capabilities. We then protect, prevent bad things from occurring. If something bypasses our protective capabilities, we detect it. And when we detect it, we, of course, have to respond and therefore recover to it. And so it easily, simply describes the overall life cycle of security. But it's not just this high-level view. If we double-click on this and go the next level deeper, it then also defines the various categories. Now, right? If you can squint and read this here, the category, we've got typical things like identity access management, data security, access control, detective capabilities, and so on. So hopefully you can start to see how it's clear that we can map back our specific controls from our control frameworks to each of these core functions in the cybersecurity framework itself. And to take that even further, if we double click on it again and zoom in on just the protect capability, you can see that not only do we have the category, we've got a subcategory, but we've got various references on the far right. Now, a quick word of warning, there's going to be a pop quiz test at the end of this too, so everybody got to remember everything on the right-hand side here. But all kidding aside, you can see that it references not only the 853 controls, but it also references the CSC, critical security controls, the CIS controls as well. So you can see how you can map your various controls, the specific technical activities that you're implementing, to the higher level function of the cybersecurity framework itself. And on this slide, we've mapped the, all, at a high level, the top 20 controls to each of the corresponding cybersecurity framework functions and categories here. Now, if you just glance at this, I'm going to pause just for a minute. If you glance at this, right, you can see that there is a gap somewhere. Where is there a gap? Yeah, that's right. There, I heard it over here on the left-hand side. There is a gap at the top, the identify function, in more of the governance and risk management related capabilities. You can see that in the top right, there are no CIS controls mapped to those. And that's not to say that that's bad. That's not to say that the CIS controls are bad. It's just that the CIS controls have more of a technical focus in terms of the technical controls that we want to implement. And so for us, in terms of building our programs, we have to recognize, well, what's the cookbook? What's the recipe? How do we think about this from an overall perspective? And recognizing that we've got to combine the control framework with the program framework to give us a higher level view to make sure that we've got all of these different gaps filled. So in terms of mapping between different frameworks, control and program frameworks, remember, they are not mutually exclusive. They support each other, and the mapping, an example that we saw on the previous slide, they connect to each other, and again, calling out that master mapping spreadsheet tool as an example of this, in terms of being able to take the technical activities and over time mapping those to the different functions in our overall program. And that is a key activity that we as CISOs, managers, leaders, need to do for our organizations to get that higher level view. So that is program frameworks there. But now remember, it's not enough to have your shopping list. It's not enough to have your recipe or cookbook. To be a master chef, right, you want to open up a place that people will want to flock to. And how do you understand how to manage and assess and analyze what your business, what your customers actually want, so that they'll keep coming back? Well, that brings us to various risk frameworks in terms of how do we structure our overall risk management processes, how do we identify, measure, and quantify risk, and therefore, how do we prioritize what we're going to do first? How do we prioritize our various security activities? So we're going to talk about a few different risk-related frameworks in this section here. The first ones that we're going to go ahead and talk about are the various NIST, again, National Institute of Standards and Technology, risk standards. Now, has anybody else read these various NIST standards that we're referencing here? Oh, not too many, maybe 5, 10% of folks, right? So when you read all of these, you will find that there are three different ones. First, NIST SP 839. 839 refers to the overall risk management process that is composed of, essentially, in short, these four circles that we see here on the slide. If you don't remember anything else about 839, just remember that it's got these four circles associated with them. In the middle, we've got the framing. The framing refers to your organizational context, your business context, those business goals that we had mentioned, what is important to the organization itself. But it also then goes on to talk about not only how do you assess risk, which we'll mention a little bit more in a moment, how do you respond to that risk, and then how do you continuously monitor risk in your organization. That's 839 at a high level. Now, 837, what is that? 837 is your RMF, your risk management framework, specifically for federal information systems. Taking those four circles and saying, okay, how do I apply that to the federal systems under my purview? And then finally, 830 refers to assessment, specifically the assessment circle at the top. Who here has to follow these, any or all of these NIST risk management standards? Just a handful of folks. I apologize in advance, right? But all kidding aside, right? So these are the NIST standards. So let's go ahead and zoom in to 830 in particular. Now, 830 specifically talks about four steps for your risk assessment process: preparing for the assessment, conducting the assessment itself to analyze and understand various risks. Step three on the far left-hand side, communicating about those risks to the various other parts of the organization. And then finally, step four on the right, maintaining the results. Keep this kind of high-level diagram in mind, because we're going to see a similar diagram on an upcoming slide here that we're going to tie back to this. So that's the overall high-level assessment process. Now, just quick word on the RMF, risk management framework itself. Now, even though this is originally intended for federal information systems, this one is useful because I find that in our day-to-day work, our teams have to manage risk. And sometimes in the day-to-day minutia of managing risk, people can get a little bit lost in the weeds. At least you lose the forest for the trees. Well, here, right, you've got six different steps. And it's useful for us to go back and say, oh, well, we just happen to be on step number three, where we're implementing the controls. And once we get these other activities out of the way, then we can move on to assessing, authorizing, monitoring the controls as well. So your overall risk assessment process here. Now, that brings us to the next one in terms of ISO 27005. Earlier, we mentioned that ISO 27000 is a whole series, a family of standards related to security. The one related to risk management, is, of course, 27005. A couple slides ago, I mentioned, keep this diagram in mind, because it is very similar to what we saw from the overall risk assessment process for NIST 830. But there's a couple small modifications. Did anybody notice? Down here at the bottom, this also includes risk treatment and risk acceptance, because 27005 talks about the overall risk management process, not just the risk assessment process that NIST 830 actually talks about. All right, so that is 27005. Couple more that we want to mention from an overall risk perspective. Now, when you read all of those different risk-related documents, they all say that you can measure risk, you can analyze risk qualitatively. Now, I'm going to venture to guess that the vast majority of us here in the room measure risk in our organizations qualitatively, using a low, medium, and high scale. Quick show of hands, who still uses a qualitative analysis approach in their organizations? It's okay if you do, right? Many folks. Now, FAIR goes on to say, describe an approach, an ontology, a taxonomy, for describing risk in more quantitative terms. So all of the risk frameworks that we just mentioned up to this point, they leave it open-ended. They say you can analyze risk qualitatively, quantitatively, or semi-quantitatively, using a hybrid approach. Now, for many years, right, we said, well, how would we go about measuring that in a quantitative way? This is where FAIR, Factor Analysis of Information Risk, comes into play. And it is a complement to those other risk management frameworks, approaches that we mentioned. Now, quick word, FAIR is supported by two different organizations. One is the FAIR Institute, fairinstitute.org, that promotes not only FAIR, but good risk management practices, and the Open Group, which is an open standards organization that has published a FAIR taxonomy and the FAIR analysis standards here in terms of how that quantitative analysis can actually be conducted. So what does FAIR actually look like? Well, this is the FAIR model here. And on the left-hand side, we've got what they call loss event frequency, the equivalent of likelihood, and loss magnitude on the right-hand side in terms of the impact to our organizations. But look at on the left-hand side, it also includes threat event frequency and vulnerability. And so keep this in mind here. Keep this in mind. Because at a high level, we know that at a very high level, risk is made up of two different factors. Right? Risk is impact times likelihood. How bad is it, and how likely is it that it will actually occur? Now, drilling down just a little bit here, now we can quibble over the specific terms that are used in the industry, but at a high level, therefore, risk is impact times likelihood, which likelihood is composed of vulnerability. Vulnerability, what are the weaknesses, misconfigurations, issues in our environment, and threat. Right? What is the likelihood that somebody wants to target us? Is there a threat actor, an adversary that's actually targeting our organization? And so when we manage risk, historically we in security have focused on which of these three components of risk? Whoever answers first will get some free coffee at the next break. Traditionally in the security industry, which of these three components, impact, vulnerability, and threat, have our tools and processes been focused on managing? Vulnerability. You all said it, right? Vulnerability. And so, but we've got to keep in mind, to effectively manage risk for our organization, we not only have to think about the vulnerability, right? It's easy for us to scan our organization, scan for issues, find weaknesses, find vulnerabilities, but we've also got to think about the threat. Right? And we've also got to think about the impact. How bad is it to our organization? Now, specifically, from a threat perspective, this brings us to our last framework that we'll mention here, is your historical, your traditional intrusion kill chain. Now, your intrusion kill chain describes in the 7-step process here, in terms of recon on the left, all the way to actions, actions on objectives in the lower right-hand corner, what your adversary, what the attacker has to do to be successful when targeting your organization. And in security, because as you all just said, we have historically focused on the vulnerability component of the risk equation. And a lot of times, this has led to an oversized, perhaps, focus on the exploitation phase here in the middle. Is the attacker sends us something, and we get exploited. We get targeted in that particular sense. Exploitation actually works, right? Therefore, there's a lot of focus on zero-day, previously unknown vulnerabilities. Well, the whole point of the intrusion kill chain is to say, hey, if you can potentially break any one of these links in the chain, well, you could therefore mitigate the attack and therefore mitigate the threat component of our overall risk equation. So that was the various control frameworks, program frameworks, and risk frameworks, frameworks that inform how we think about risk for our organizations. So in summary, right, as you mature your security program, from each of these three different categories that we discussed, make sure that you choose one or more of these frameworks to implement in your organizations. The control framework, our list of ingredients, what do we need to buy, what do we need to implement? Our program frameworks to give us a higher level view to better communicate what we're doing from an overall security perspective. And then finally, our risk frameworks here in terms of understanding how we prioritize, how do we decide what to actually do first. And so, in terms of takeaways for tomorrow, for next week, well, make sure that you understand what are the frameworks that you're using in your organizations. Before the cybersecurity framework was created, published in 2014, I was part of other organizations before that. And we were looking around, looking for different frameworks that we should implement. And of course, 27,000 existed at the time. But when we looked at it, we said, you know, this is a little bit too rigorous. This is a little bit too much for where we are from a maturity perspective. So we implemented our own security framework that, in retrospect, looked very similar to the cybersecurity framework. Well, and it was fine. We got a lot of good internal buy-in, a lot of good internal adoption for it. Well, as the years progressed and as the cybersecurity framework became more and more understood, well, we got natural questions from our leadership that said, why? Well, we understand this internal framework that you've been telling us about, but why aren't we using an industry-recognized framework like the cybersecurity framework? So what did we have to do in response over time to that comment? We had to switch. We had to switch to use the cybersecurity framework. It wasn't all that different, but the leadership was asking, right, why aren't you using an industry-recognized framework? So think about, over the next 3 months, not only what frameworks do you have in place, but how those frameworks are leveraged, how they're mapped to each other. That's the key activity from a mapping perspective. And then within 6 months, longer term, think about updating your overall program to leverage each of the three different types of frameworks. And from an implementation perspective, get the buy-in, socialization with your various technical, operations, and executive teams. So that was making sense of cybersecurity frameworks. Key takeaway, how do you think about where they fit into those program, control, and risk frameworks that we just mentioned? Contact information here on the slide, and that is all I have today. Thank you guys very much.